morning.
Good morning.
Welcome to you who are guests today. Welcome to you who are joining us by means of video. Welcome to you who are members of God's family here in Lebanon Church. May God bless us together. This is a special Sunday. This is a Sunday where we remember and celebrate the ascension of our Lord Jesus Christ. Ascension Day was this past Thursday, but we'll be focusing especially today on Jesus being taken into heaven, being hidden by that cloud of God's glory with a promise that one day Jesus will come again. Let's bow before our God in silent prayer and ask Him to prepare our hearts for worship today. Psalm 24. Who may ascend the mountain of the Lord? Who may stand in his holy place? Lift up your heads, you gates. Be lifted up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is this King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Lift up your heads, you gates. Lift them up, you ancient doors, that the King of glory may come in. Who is he, this King of glory? The Lord Almighty, He is the King of glory. Grace and peace are yours. From God our Father, our Lord Jesus Christ, through the work of the Holy Spirit, to this let God's people say, Amen. Would you take a moment also to welcome each other in the name and grace of Jesus? This is the account of the ascension of Jesus from the Gospel of Luke, Luke 24. When he had led them out to the vicinity of Bethany, he lifted up his hands and blessed them. While he was blessing them, he left them and was taken up into heaven. Then they worshiped him and returned to Jerusalem with great joy, and they stayed continually at the temple, praising God. God has ascended amid shouts of joy, the Lord amid the sounding of trumpets. Sing praises to God, sing praises to our King, sing praises, for God is the King of all the earth. Sing to Him a psalm of praise.
Let's all sing together, Jesus is Lord.
Oh,
Josie Moss, we welcome you this morning and look forward to your special music today. Josie, thank you for leading us in that beautiful, prayerful song. And may God bless you, and may He bless us all as He answers those prayers. This is the Sunday we remember, especially the Ascension. the Lordship of Jesus Christ. In that spirit, let's bow before our God now in a prayer, confessing our sins. Almighty God and Father, you have raised Jesus from death to life and crowned him Lord of all. We confess that we have not bowed down before him. We have not acknowledged his rule in our lives as we ought. We've gone along with the ways of the world. We've failed to give our Lord Jesus the glory that he deserves. We pray now, Father, as you've promised for his sake, for Jesus' sake, that you would forgive us. And more than that, Father, that you would raise us from sin, that we would not sit easy in our sin and simply take advantage of your forgiveness, but that you would raise us to new life. Make us a people of faithfulness who obey the commands of the Lord Jesus Christ, the one who rules the world, the one who is head of the church, the one who is our Savior and King. Amen. This is the word of promise that we hear from the epistle of Ephesians chapter 2, verses 4 through 7. But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. The incomparable riches of his grace. Do we understand, do we fathom how generous God is with his forgiveness and how lavishly he has poured the grace of Jesus Christ upon us? We are forgiven. We are made new. We have been given the gift of the Holy Spirit. God is ours. We belong to him. Let us rejoice in that and give our lives of gratitude to him. And so, would you join with me in reading responsibly these questions and answers from the Heidelberg Catechism? The question is, we have been delivered from our misery by God's grace alone through Christ, and not because we have earned it. Why then must we still do good? To be sure, Christ has redeemed us by his blood. But we do good because Christ, by his Spirit, is also renewing us to be like himself, so that in all our living we may show that we are thankful to God for all he has done for us, and so that he may be praised through us. And we do good so that we may be assured of our faith by its fruits, and so that by our godly living our neighbors may be won over to Christ. What does God's law require of us? Christ teaches us this in summary in Matthew 22. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. Let's respond to God by singing Jesus Shall Reign.
Thank you. God's word and to hear what God would say to us today. We need God's help to do that. Let me lead you in a prayer for illumination. Lord, let your light shine upon us. Let the light of your word shine upon our hearts. Let the glory of God fill our hearts and minds. Let the word of our God dwell richly within us. Help us, Lord, to receive your word as good news to us. May this Bible be an open book. May the words of our mouths and meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight. Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. We've already read one account from Luke, from the Gospel of Luke, of the ascension of Jesus Christ. Luke wrote a second account of the ascension of Christ, which is recorded for us in the book of Acts. This morning, reading Acts 1, verses 1 through 14. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: "Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit." Then they gathered around him and asked him, "Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. "Men of Galilee," they said, "why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus, who has been taken from you into heaven, will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven." Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Brothers and sisters in Christ, I have two questions for you this morning. What is your favorite Christmas carol? I don't want you to share it, but I want you to think, what is your favorite Christmas carol? Think about that. Do you have one? I'm not going to ask what it is, but do you have a favorite Christmas carol, or two, or three? Okay, that's the first question. That was the easy one. Second question is this: what is your favorite Ascension Day hymn? Can you think of an Ascension Day hymn? Would you recognize an Ascension Day hymn if you sung it? We just passed Ascension Day this past Thursday with hardly a notice. Ascension Day gets no recognition, no attention from us, no good songs. Advent and Christmas, on the other hand, gets all kinds of attention, all kinds of celebration. You don't even have to go to church to know that Christmas is coming. You don't have to go to church to know that, you know what, Christmas isn't about trees and presents and things, but it's really about something that happened in Bethlehem a long time ago when this very special son was born to Mary, a virgin. Christmas gets all kinds of attention, and Ascension Day, nothing. And some of that makes sense, I suppose, because what is easier to relate to than the story of a little baby? And what would be more wonderful than to remember and celebrate that in this little baby, God is with us. God has come to us. God is here. Ascension Day, Jesus is standing near Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, standing there with his disciples, answering some obscure question with a kind of a strange answer. And we're going to look at the question and the answer here shortly. Saying these things, and then as the disciples watch, Jesus leaves. Jesus leaves. And why in the world would we sing about that? God is gone. Up into that cloud. They can't see him anymore. And they wonder what it means. But in the same way as when John the Baptist was going to be born, and when Jesus was going to be born, and when Joseph and Mary needed special directions to understand what to do next around those times of Christmas, angels show up and angels tell the people what to do and what this means. And so now at the ascension of Jesus, once again, we see angels, two men standing in white. Were they the same angels, I wonder, as had stood at the tomb? And asked, why are you looking for Jesus? We don't know. Could be. Why are you looking in the sky? Angels keep asking questions. They don't tell you, they ask you. And they ask you questions that I suppose would make you feel foolish. Why are you looking for Jesus in this empty tomb? Don't you remember what he said? And now as they watch Jesus go into heaven, the angels are asking this question again. What are you doing? Why are you looking up in the sky and into heaven? Don't you understand? This Jesus who was taken to heaven, taken from you as you watched him go, one day will return as you've seen him ascend into heaven. And they look, wonder. What strange days these have been. Jesus arose from the dead and started appearing suddenly to his disciples behind closed doors, and they would be eating a meal and the doors would be locked because they didn't want the enemies of Jesus to find the followers of Jesus and to do to them what they did to Jesus. But Jesus would appear and show his hands inside and eat fish and tell them about the kingdom of God. And he kept doing this over and over again for 40 days. And I wonder what that was like. One of my favorite, or I would say most intriguing descriptions of the appearances of Jesus is one that we read this morning from the Gospel of Luke, from Luke 24. The risen Jesus, who is leading his disciples through the streets of Jerusalem. Jesus now not just appearing to his disciples behind locked doors and in secret places, but Jesus walking and leading his disciples toward Bethany. He's outside. He's where I think other people would be able to see him. Jesus wasn't invisible. Did other people in Jerusalem from time to time see this risen Jesus and wonder what was going on? I don't know. I don't know. The disciples are trying to make sense of all of this. Jesus who taught them and did miracles, Jesus who died, Jesus who rose from the grave, Jesus who's appearing to them now, this Jesus who is the Son of God, he's the Son of David, and they ask this question. The question in verse 6 of Acts 1, they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? It's a good question. Lord, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Because after all, the disciples know that that's how the story goes. You see, there's this Son of David who again is going to sit on the throne of God's people. That's how the story goes. There was this promise that God made to Abraham long ago. I'm going to make a great nation of you, Abraham, and to your descendants, I'm going to give this land. This belongs to you. You are my people. This is your land. The Son of David will be your king. It's a good question. This is how the story goes. And this is Jesus. So it's not only a good question, it's a faithful question. It's a confession of a question. Because they say to Jesus, Lord, are you now going to keep all of these promises and make it all come to pass? It's a confession. Lord, we believe that you are the Christ. We believe that you are the one who has the authority. You're the one who has the victory. You're the one that God has sent to do this here. So now, at this time, are you going to restore the kingdom to Israel? This is day 40. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Israel? John Calvin had something to say about that question. In his commentary, John Calvin said, there are as many errors as there are words in that question. There are as many mistakes as there are words in that question. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Because the disciples are thinking of the way that they understand the story goes. Now in verse 7, it doesn't sound like Jesus is exactly answering the disciples' question. Because it's a yes or no question. Are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Yes or no? And he starts talking about times and dates and receiving the Holy Spirit and being witnesses in Jerusalem, Judea, and Samaria. He starts talking about a gift a task and a promise. It doesn't sound like Jesus is answering the question, but actually, he really is. Are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? Are you going to restore the kingdom? First of all, the gift. The gift. Instead of kicking Caesar out of Jerusalem, Jesus said that he and the Father would send the Holy Spirit. Are you going to restore the kingdom? And Jesus says, well, the answer is you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. How is that the kingdom of God? I'll tell you that there were two kings in the Old Testament who understood that the kingdom of God was not just a matter of getting a crown, getting a throne, and getting some people to rule over a particular place on earth. That's not the kingdom of God. King Saul and King David both knew that there is no kingdom of God apart from the Spirit of God. You remember, don't you, that the people of Israel were asking for a king, and so through the prophet Samuel, the Lord anointed, provided a king for his people who were asking, and that first king was King Saul. You also remember that King Saul was not entirely obedient. God would give commands and directions, and Saul would kind of keep those commandments, but he wouldn't keep them specifically. And so the Lord sent Samuel back to Saul with this message. Saul, God has rejected you as king. God is no longer with you. You have the crown, you have the throne, you have the people, you have the land, but you don't have me. You don't have me. You know, that bothered Saul. He was going to face a very important, very difficult, very dangerous battle. And Saul, because he knew he did not have the Lord, he wanted some kind of direction, so he went to a witch in Endor. And he asked the witch in Endor to call up the now dead spirit of the prophet Samuel. Because Saul wanted to speak to Samuel and have some kind of reassurance that he would still succeed, that he would still be able to gain victory in the kingdom of God. And he saw the spirit of Samuel or whatever happened there. But the word that King Saul heard was that God still was not with him. And soon Saul would perish in battle. He died. King David, after King Saul, sinned against God. And when he was finally convicted of that sin with Bathsheba, through the confrontation that another prophet of God, Nathan, had with King David, David's heart was broken, and he was afraid. God, don't take your Holy Spirit from me. Psalm 51. Because King David realized, too, that apart from the gift of the Spirit of God, the presence of God, there was no kingdom. The word of Jesus to his disciples is this. The kingdom of God isn't about a particular place, and it's not about conquering enemies. It's about the gift of God himself to you. And if I go, the Father and I will send you the Holy Spirit. That's the gift. You will have a closer fellowship with God because of the gift of this Holy Spirit than you have had walking with me all of these years of training and discipleship and now witnessing my glory in my resurrection over death. You will have a closer fellowship with God because of the gift of the Holy Spirit than has ever before been possible. And this is the key to the kingdom of God. You will have the power of God. You will have the authority of God. You will have God with you to accomplish what God wants to see happen. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? That's the second part of the question. And that goes to the task. You will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you. That's the gift. And you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. You will begin right here in your task is to tell the people of Jerusalem who know the word of God so well that these promises in God's word have been fulfilled in Jesus Christ. You tell them that. That's your task. And from Jerusalem, you move out to Judea, to the surrounding countryside and peoples and towns and nation. And you tell them, Jesus is Lord. And then, yes, you go a little further. You go now to Samaria, to those black sheep cousins of yours. Those people that have a different understanding and not a very faithful understanding of the Old Testament. And you tell them, too, that Jesus is Lord. And you go to the ends of the earth, and Jesus is claiming not only Israel, not only this particular nation, where Jesus saves just my clan, just my people, just people that look like me, the people that I like, but Jesus claims the whole world. Jesus imagines that this gospel, this word that he is Lord and King, is going to go to Lebanon, the ends of the earth. Here we are. And that's our task, too. He's given us the gift of the Holy Spirit. He's given us the task of his kingdom. He calls us to tell other people that Jesus is Lord. That's how the kingdom grows. Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom to Israel? That's the third part of the question. It's the thing that they say first. But is it going to happen now? And Jesus says, it isn't for us to know the Father's calendar or clock, the Father's seasons or dates. However, Jesus says, not that, well, I don't know what's going to happen next. We'll give you the Holy Spirit, and we'll give you this task, and we'll see how it works out and where things go. Well, then God will see, and we'll decide then what happens. That's not what Jesus says. He gives a promise. There are times and dates that the Father has set by his authority. And the Father is bringing this world, this age, to its appointed end. This world will not end by disaster or disease or war. That's not what decides how this world ends and what happens to us. This world will not finally end when we have discovered everything there is to discover and answer every question there is to be asked. When we finally know everything and know how to do everything, then everything will be perfect and the world will come to its goal, its end, its conclusion. That's not how it ends either. This age, this world is coming to an end. And God will do it. More than that, God will do it when the task is accomplished, when his work is done, when his kingdom is complete. And that's what's going on right now, you see. The Holy Spirit is here. And God calls us again today to believe that, to remember that. The Holy Spirit is here. The Holy Spirit is ours. And apart from the Holy Spirit, we are not the church. Apart from the Holy Spirit, we are not Christians. Apart from the Holy Spirit, we are not the people of God. But when the Holy Spirit comes, if we are the people of God, the Holy Spirit is here. The Holy Spirit is here. The Holy Spirit is here. And not in our ability, not with our words, but through the power and equipping and the gifting of the Holy Spirit, we have this task to bring the gospel of Jesus Christ, the word of forgiveness of sins, the word of eternal life over death, the word of rescue from hell and the glory of heaven. To bring that good news every corner of the world, and to our neighbors too. And that God says this: the time that we are living in right now is not time, first of all, to be used to advance our own agendas. Let me say that more simply. We're not punching a time clock. We're not figuring out what we're going to do with our work and our week in order to make ourselves rich. That's not what time is about. That's not what life is about. The goal is the growth of the kingdom. And if we have days and weeks and opportunity and education and Holy Spirit, God calls us to use the time and space and gifts he's given us now to advance the glory of Jesus. Until God decides that it's finished. And he promises Jesus will return. He went into that cloud of glory. Not the cloud of a thunderstorm or a snowstorm, but the same cloud that appeared on Sinai, the same cloud that filled the tabernacle, the same cloud that filled the temple. The cloud of God's glory, which veils the sight of God from the eyes of creatures. Jesus went there. We should rejoice. Because Jesus went there not only as the Son of God, but he went there as the Son of Adam. He went there as one of us, and he went there in his own right. And Jesus has told us wherever he goes, he takes us with him. We have the privilege of knowing that God accepts us, that God loves us, that God uses us, that God fills us, and that God calls us to do his work. All because Jesus is at the right hand of the Father. Jesus says this is what life is all about. It's about his kingdom and our part in it. Let's pray. It is hard for us to get our minds and hearts wrapped around the thing that happened when you, Lord Jesus, were taken to heaven and seated in glory and honor at the right hand of the Father. But you have died for our sins and for the sins of all sinners who come to you in faith. You are raised in the hope of eternal life for all who believe in you, that we too will be raised to new, glorious, and eternal life. You receive the welcome of God, telling us that we too will be welcomed by God forever. And you have established your kingdom. Help us to receive the gift of your Holy Spirit faithfully, to do your task diligently, and to look forward to the future, hopefully. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand to sing, "Rejoice, the Lord is King." Said today that Pam is able to have visitors, would appreciate visitors or phone calls. Her pain is manageable. There is pain, but they're encouraged, and they welcome any support and company that we can give to Pam. Are there things that you wish to share today for prayer requests? exploding and the missiles are flying, I don't think what first comes to mind is which side you're on. It's what is going to happen to me. We need to pray for these people. Let's pray. Lord Jesus Christ, we exalt you today as Lord of creation. The beauty of the creation that we enjoy is a testimony to the truth and goodness of your word, which spoke this creation into being. And Lord, we continue to benefit from the care that the Father gives to creation. So grateful for the gift of rain this past week, and so trusting, Father, that you will continue to provide the rain and moisture that will be needed for this coming growing season. And Lord, you are the Lord who must bless our work so that we may prosper by it and so that our work may be a blessing to others around us. Help us, Lord, to see in our work that in all things we are contributing in love to the good of our neighbors, the glory of your name. Encourage us in our work, we pray. Encourage us in those seasons of training and education for the work that you will call us to do one day. We think, Lord, today of those who are finishing high school, those who are now finished from a season of education in college, those who are teaching and providing for teachers and support. We pray, Lord, for your blessing, for education, for Christian education. You are head of the church and Lord of our lives. We pray today for your blessing on the ministry of your church. We thank you for Lebanon Christian Reformed Church. And we ask for a rich measure of your spirit to lead and equip our deacons, our elders, me, and each member of this congregation. Help us, Lord, to be a blessing in this part of your kingdom. With our brothers and sisters in Sioux Center, we pray today for your blessing for Faith Christian Reformed Church, for Pastors Bob Hollema, Pastor Dave Smith, Pastor Cliff Hookstrom. We ask, Lord, that you would provide for them and encourage each member of that church as they too serve with us for the cause of your gospel and kingdom. Be with Soss and Kara, with Steve and Tara, our mission partners. Lord, bless their work and provide for them. Be with Cornerstone Prison Church and their ongoing search for pastoral leadership in that unique ministry. We pray, Lord, for the members of Cornerstone Prison Church. This has been a long stretch where they have had much responsibility on their shoulders, guiding that part of your body behind prison walls. We pray for your blessing today for our brothers there. Again, we pray for Siouxland Unity Church. Thankful 2 weeks ago for the time that we had to get acquainted with and draw closer in our respect and love and care for each other. Give your blessing to them today, we pray. Bless to the offerings that are given today for Reframe Ministries, for the media outreach of the Christian Reformed Church. We pray that through the variety of means that you, Lord Jesus, may be made known to the world. We do pray for our world, Lord. We pray for our nation, for each of its leaders, for each of its citizens. These have been challenging and divisive times. Lord, we pray that you would draw us together, that you would grant us peace, ability to hear, understand, to grow together as a nation blessed by you. We pray for the nations of the world. We think today of the turmoil going on in the Middle East right now. Lord, we pray for every effort there is to bring peace in that land and people so torn for so long by violence. We lift today, Lord, the needs and concerns of the people of this congregation, of our friends and family. Today, especially, our hearts and minds turn to Pam Deckers. We pray that you would bless her therapy and the progress of her recovery, and that you would provide for Harry and Pam and all that they need. Be with Adrian Croy and Greta. Bless them and encourage them. With Christina Van Der Esch. Lord, we're so grateful that she was able to join us last week. And we pray for your special blessing for her today. Father, for those who are near to us, whose names are always close to our hearts, those who are going through times of sadness, times of pain, times of great question, and times of joy, we pray, Lord, that you would remember and keep each of these who are so dear to us. May they know your blessing. Father in heaven, lift our hearts to you. Help us to give our lives to you faithfully and obediently in all things. Hear our prayer for Jesus' sake. Amen. Let's stand together as we hear the Lord's blessing received and given to us. Let's stand. People of God, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be yours now and forever. Let God's people say.